So other patients, okay, can watch this later. So as I said, I would like to introduce Dr. Randall. Dr. Lor Randall is an internationally recognized sarcoma surgeon, educator, and researcher. He's also the chair of the Department of Orthopaedic Surgery at UC Davis, and he holds the David Linn Endowed Chair in Orthopaedic Surgery. As the chair, he leads more than 70 surgeons, physicians, researchers, and trainees who provide a full spectrum of specialty care for adults and children with musculoskeletal conditions, including TGCT. The department is nationally ranked with an international reputation for excellence in clinical care and innovations, partnering with UCD's world-renowned veterinary medicine, biochemical engineering, and other schools. Dr. Randall has authored in numerous peer-reviewed articles, book chapters, and abstracts in the field of sarcoma surgery and biology. He has also received numerous nationally and internationally ranked awards and has helped develop adolescent and young adult cancer care programs at Utah and UC Davis. I will also introduce Dr. Copenhaver, who is just signing in, I think, right now. Let me let him in. Sorry, give me 2 seconds. Let's see. I made him co-host, so he should be able to turn his camera on. Hi, Dr. Copenhaver. I was just introducing you.
Yep, no, thank you very much. Sorry, I'm a few minutes late. Good
That's
to see
all right.
you.
So Dr. Copenhaver is an anesthesiologist and pain medicine specialist with a unique expertise in diagnosing and managing complex pain management problems of various types. Dr. Copenhaver has expertise in cancer pain management, craniofacial pain, and complex regional pain syndrome. Dr. Copenhaver believes in cancer pain management and supportive care by using all means necessary to reduce pain, improve function, and the quality of life of patients. Dr. Copenhaver has also research interests in health services administration, pain medicine education, responsible opioid therapy management, targeted drug therapy, cancer pain management, craniofacial pain, and the applied use of stem cells in the setting of intervertebral disc disease. So hopefully I captured both these amazing doctors quite well. And I will have Dr. Randall start with his presentation and then we'll move on to Dr. Copenhaver.
Okay, can everyone hear me okay? And I am going to share my screen. It's not, I don't have a prompt for it. Can you let, oh, there it is. Okay, all right, here we go. So good afternoon, good evening for those who are really far east. Thank you for the opportunity to work with Dr. Copenhaver and the LifeRF group to talk to you a little bit about TGCT. And we'll talk a little bit about surgical management, but we'll sort of do a sweeping overview. And then I'll turn over to Dr. Copenhaver. And please send questions as we go. I'm also happy to pause. I don't feel like we need to get through all of the slide deck necessarily. Death by PowerPoint can sometimes be painful. So we don't want that to happen. Sorry, let me get it on. There we go. Okay, so this is just the cover slide. Obviously, this is sort of what it can look like. If I was a nice illustration, you can have a most common site is the swollen knee, a big bulky tumor in the knee, but we see it around the hand and small digits or small joints as well, usually in the tenosynovium or the tendon sheath. And this is sort of artist representation of what it looks like in the knee. And what's really important is historically it's been a surgical disease, but it's multi-team management, transdisciplinary management, working with our pain specialists and our medical oncologists. It is not a cancer. Many of the patients that will come to see me are understandably apprehensive when I say they're going to see a medical oncologist. They think that somehow this might be a cancer disease. It is not. It is not pre-malignant. And it's just very important to appreciate that point. There we go. These are my disclosures that I have done some consulting with Daiichi Sankyo. And we've opened the Decipher trial at our institution as well, but they don't really influence anything I'm about, we'll say here. Our department is vision and mission focused. We won't go into this here, but I like to have this up whenever I give these talks. We like to really promulgate knowledge and educate patients in this disease. It's important to us. So what is TGCT? It is tenosynovial giant cell tumor is the name. It formerly has been called pigmented villonodular synovitis or giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. It is completely benign and can arise in a joint or on a tendon sheath. And this is what what we call a photomicrograph of it would look like on the right. If you were to take the tumors out and look at them underneath the microscope, you'd see this brown sort of variated appearance with some what we call hemosiderin, which is iron deposits in the soft tissues. Patients will usually present, as many of you unfortunately may know already, with pain, swelling, and stiffness. It can be ongoing or intermittent. It tends to be progressive. The mean age of presentation is 46, but we see it in younger people and older people. The knee, as I've said, is the most common. If for whatever reason your physician aspirates the joint, they'll usually find a crude motor oil appearance to it. It's this sort of tarry looking sap that comes out of the joint. And that what that is the cells mixed in with some of the synovial fluid, which is the lubrication of the joint. It can be misdiagnosed as rheumatoid arthritis, sometimes an infection and other processes that involve the joint. And you see on the caricature on the right, that's sort of the anatomic breakdown of where we see it, with the knee again being the most common. It comes in basically two forms, the more nodular form and the diffuse form. And you're seeing a nodular picture up here on the right. This is an MRI, and you're looking at the knee joint from the side, what we call the sagittal view. And it's this black, dark thing there in the knee. And it has a very discrete mass. And this is what it looks like if you pluck it out. And when you pluck it out, usually that takes care of it. And that's a good thing. And they'll usually go away and you don't have to worry about it. The diffuse type, just by the nature that they're so diffuse, they can be really extensive. And surgeons can go in with an arthroscope, which is a camera and shaver device through a minimally invasive technique, or do an open, what we call arthrotomy, and open it all out. And it's much harder to control just because it's so extensive. And this is a picture of the diffuse type on the right. And no matter what we do, it just seems to too often keep growing back. But as I've said, when you scour the literature and you do a Google search on this, you'll hear the term pigmented villonodular synovitis or PVNS. And you'll also hear giant cell tumor of tendon sheath. Both of these should not be confused with another entity called giant cell tumor of bone. Giant cell tumor of bone is not anything to do with these conditions. They both have giant cells in them, but that's the end of it. And so it's very important for you to take a takeaway from this is not to confuse this with giant cell tumor of bone. And it can get pretty confusing, but we do use this diffuse form as PVNS and a more nodular form, giant cell tumor of tendon sheath, but the whole family is called tenosynovial giant cell tumor, TGCT. And just another caricature to drive home the point, intra-articular means in the joint. So this is a femur bone, and any joint is by definition a one bone connected to another bone and all the soft tissue therein. And so this is the lower end of the femur bone, and obviously the knee joint is the lower end of the femur bone with the upper edge of the tibia bone or shin bone with the kneecap, which we call the patella. And extra-articular means outside the joint. And just again, to re-emphasize diffuse, tends to see in larger joints. It's much more extensive. It's harder to control, and the recurrence rates can be anywhere from 50 to 70%. If it's not too heavily involved, sometimes the recurrence rates are lower than that. But if it's really diffuse, it can really be a hard thing to control with surgery. Localized again, smaller joints or actually outside the joint. Most of the ones that will involve the hand are on the tendon sheaths and not the joint itself. They're usually single, they're less aggressive. They can be taken out with surgery, and that usually takes care of it. But I see a lot of these patients, and we do tell them, even with a well-done surgery and they have a smaller nodular one, there is the chance of recurrence. About 90%, unfortunately, or I should say fortunately, are localized. You can see this pie here. There's about 15,000 cases per year, and surgeons usually can just manage those, but the more diffuse type makes up about 10%, and they can be a really big challenge. What causes this condition? It's not something you were exposed to. It's not something you've thought. It's not for doing your homework as a child. It's just one of these sporadic things that happens, unfortunately. But we do know a bit about the biology. There's not really a genetic predisposition that we know of. It doesn't run in families. If you have it, it doesn't mean your children are more likely for having it. Or if you're a younger person, take care of someone, a parent with it, it doesn't mean that you're likely to get it, okay? It's really a random event, and there's no causative, like cigarettes and lung cancer and sun exposure and melanoma. There's no relationship there at all. Now, interestingly, the body is composed of lots and lots and lots of cells, 100 trillion to be exact, which is more stars than there are in the galaxy, okay? And all of these cells have different functions. You can see up on the caricatures, this is a cardiomyocyte, which means it's the muscle of the heart. We have liver cells up on the upper right. We have fat cells on the lower. And then we have the immune system, or the white blood cells there on the lower left. And there's a variety of different types, which we'll talk about in a minute. But what's important is that these cells certain types of cells, which we'll talk about, do lead to this condition of TGCT. But the dogma of tumor biology is that a cell defines the biology of the tumor, and the location influences the treatment plan. As an oncologist, it's fair to say that we're getting more sophisticated in overall cancer biology, that we start to think about pathways of disease, metabolic pathways of tumors, not just the cell type, but the historical dogma of tumors is that it's really a function of the cell type. We do a biopsy and we confirm that this is TGCT. It's looked at by a pathologist, and then usually an orthopedic oncologist is referred. If it's really diffuse, sometimes they'll see a medical oncologist contemporaneously. But again, it's the cell types that defines the biology of this, for all three of these names that you see out there. But again, we're calling it tenosynovial giant cell tumor. And that's basically, it's important to highlight that it's part of the constituency of this is the fibroblast. This is connective tissue. The fibroblast is the glue that holds your body together. It holds your muscles in place. It holds your bones in place. It holds your organs in place. This fibroblastic tissue is the background upon which this tumor arises. But it's really these macrophages, part of the immune system, that drive the process. The background is the fibroblast, but the immune system is what really stimulates the formation of this. And the monocytes and the macrophages are the main drivers of it. And we do know a fair bit of biology about this, and I'm sure many of you have already sort of looked into this a little bit, and there have been other webinars sponsored by a variety of people looking at this. But there's this colony stimulating factor 1, or CSF1, that really causes these tumor-associated macrophages to proliferate and causes the inflammation. So these TGCT cells, which arise in the tumor synovium, stimulate the CSF1, and then it binds to these macrophages and causes this really painful condition that destroys the joint. And these drugs, which we're not going to spend a lot of time on today, block the CSF1. You can see here, they inhibit the CSF1R, which stands for receptor. So this molecule is secreted from the TGCT cell and then stimulates the TAM, or tumor-associated macrophage. And it's this stimulation of the tumor that causes the symptoms and pain that patients experience. So for treatment, just because you have a TGCT lesion doesn't necessarily mean you have a problem. What I mean by that is if it's not causing too much pain, there's no harm in watching these. We want to make sure they don't cause any erosions in the joints, but they can be followed. It's not like a cancer where you say you got to get it out. This is something that can be watched if the symptoms are not bothering you. And that's an important thing to take home. If surgery is needed, if it's the diffuse type, it can be managed with either arthroscopic or open surgery, and there's pros and cons of both. Radiation is very rarely used. I know of a few centers that do still use it, but my strong bias is not to use radiation because it causes its own set of issues, which I won't get into here, maybe in the Q&A if people are interested. And then the CSF1R inhibitors are really changing the game for the diffuse type as well. And before the CSF1R inhibitors came out, there was a variety of other tyrosine kinase inhibitors that were also used to try to control the disease, but they weren't biologically specific to the condition. So they didn't have as good results as the CSF1R inhibitors. So the clinical course, we've talked a little bit about how these tumors arise and how they present. Once someone's diagnosed with this TGCT, they usually will have some sort of intervention because they're causing symptoms and they see someone. So if it's localized, a surgeon may recommend surgery and that may be curative. If it's diffuse, there it gets a little bit more tricky. And my preference is to get opinions with our medical oncologists up front before I even try any surgery for the diffuse, to talk about clinical trials, to talk about CSF1R inhibitors that are available, to make sure that they make an informed decision whether or not they want to go through a surgery for diffuse type just because of the recurrence rates. I think it's important that they hear about these systemic therapies up front, and then they may want to say, well, I'll take my chance with surgery and then try it later with the drug. But that's the decision in my mind that should happen before they go through the risk of a surgery. And then again, the surgery can be done arthroscopically with sort of these little incisions like keyholes where they go in with a scope or we go in with a scope and a little shaving device to shave it out. The problem with that, with the diffuse type, I say with my patients, it's almost like a shower and a shave, and that you're going to get stubble in a matter of time as the tumor grows back. Open synovectomy can be performed as well. Open synovectomy is definitely done when the surgery is necessary in the back of the knee. Every once in a while, a joint replacement will be necessary. It's important to point out that the joint replacement doesn't preclude the TGCT from coming back. Unfortunately, the TGCT can erode the bone, and therefore a knee replacement is necessary. When a knee replacement or hip replacement or whatever joint is replaced, it can provide symptomatic relief, but there still can be symptoms related to the TGCT. Ankle fusions are usually done for disease in the ankle that isn't controlled, and very, very rarely amputation. I think it is fair to say that surgery is sort of the frontline standard of care, but if someone's recently diagnosed with a diffuse type, I think one should inquire about the CSF1R inhibitors. And then we've already talked about the recurrence rates, which I've just put up there again. So again, we're sort of winding down here. The goal is to remove all disease when we do surgery. That's very hard to achieve when you're doing it in diffuse type. Local recurrence for nodular is very small, less than 10%. In the hand, it's slightly higher than that. For the diffuse type, again, at least 40%, usually higher. We've talked a little about open versus arthroscopic. There's some. These are what we call Kaplan-Meier plots. As the line goes down, that means you're developing a recurrence. And you look there, the orange, or the red, excuse me, is the open surgery, and the The arthroscopic is the blue line. And as you're going through time, you see they're pretty much even in terms of recurrence rates. I would challenge that the arthroscope can't control the stuff in the back of the knee. That does, again, as I've said, require an open approach. Oh, I think they were supposed to, let's see. And then, sorry. So I just showed you that going back, that was the open versus closed surgery, the scope surgery. This Kaplan-Meier here is the primary versus the recurrent. And what this is important to take home is that with primary disease, that there you can get recurrence, but with recurrent disease, which is the blue line, you're very likely to get recurrence. So if you've had a surgery and it recurs, you're now the blue line. And it means that you're gonna, with more surgery, you're gonna have increasing issues of recurrence. It's not like a second surgery is gonna make you better because the first one was inadequate. It just means you're going down the rabbit hole of needing more and more surgeries. And at that point, it's definitely important to consider systemic therapy. So as we've said, surgery tends to be the first line approach. If tumors are inoperable of multiple recurrence, you should be thinking about systemic approaches. It's important, and we'll hear in just a few minutes about the other management, how to manage the pain ideally. There can be issues with mobility, joint and bone damage, as I've talked about, and the disease severity influences that. And this is really my last slide to, again, just make people aware. If you were not aware of these drugs coming in, Daiichi Sankyo has an approved drug available, and Deciphera is doing a clinical trial right now with another drug. So it's important that you come up to speed on those. And I think we're going to defer the questions to the latter part, but that ends my part right there.
Thank you, Dr. Randall. I will say that we just previously had a webinar that discussed maybe more of the drugs. So there's also mactuzumab, the AMB05X trial, as well as ABS021. So for anyone interested in more of those drugs, we do have the prior webinar that was just done a few months ago. Since we're transitioning here to Dr. Copenhaver, I figured I would ask the two main questions for the surgeon, Dr. Randall. What are the chances that PVNS can turn malignant? And then the other question is more about arthritic-based pain, and the disease can obviously cause bone erosion, or it can cause some form of bone erosion. That how does maybe that work in comparison to bone erosion seen in giant cell tumor of the bone?
Yeah, so the first question is a good one. It's very important. For all intents and purposes, it does not turn into a malignancy. There are some case reports out there of multifocal disease, and we don't honestly know if it's truly a malignancy. It's important to realize that cancer, the concept of cancer is that one cell becomes rogue and then spawns other cells that go throughout the body that can continue to change. But you can also have tumors that mimic metastasis and that they're multifocal, but it doesn't mean that this tumor here went here and is the same tumor spreading. It just means that, like popcorn, these things pop up in various areas of the body. And so we really don't know that tenosynovial giant cell tumor has really any ability to truly metastasize. And I wouldn't, there's enough to be concerned about with being treated for TGCT, but cancer should not be one of them. In terms of the joint, yes, the joint space, you can get erosions. And for diffuse type, the surgeons will often make an argument to be very aggressive with surgery to prevent those erosions from happening down the road. But the problem is, as I've alluded to, the data would say multiple surgeries doesn't control the disease, and it just caused more scarring and more problems. And so I wouldn't have multiple surgeries to try to preclude the erosions. But your orthopedic surgeon hopefully has the wherewithal to realize that the joint does need to be carefully monitored throughout all of this.
Thank you so much. Dr. Copenhaver, if you want to start as well, and I know we have plenty of questions about pain.
Sure. No, absolutely. That was fantastic. Let me make sure that I can present this here for you. And get started here. Perfect. Okay, first I should just mention, yeah, that's great. Thank you, Dr. Randall, and thanks, Sydney. I mean, in our philosophy for pain, we're going to kind of look at some non-opioid strategies, and then we'll focus on one or two opioids or one opioid strategy. But we'll talk a little bit about the specifics of this, of TGCT and the phenomenon, but how that relates to pain globally. This is actually a group here in Sacramento, painexhibit.com, and I work a lot at our cancer center and work with our patients to really focus on other strategies too to help describe how pain is really incapacitating at times, and art can be a way of at least describing it and sometimes assuaging some of the difficulties. And this is a group that actually puts together artwork produced by patients that typically are going through concerns with cancer. So no disclosures that I have. There will be some off-label discussions of medications, because this is really a full expansive review of what we have available to treat pain in these types of settings. So I think the first place is to start with what's our definition for pain. And really the suggestion, this came about in the 70s with the definition from the International Association for the Study of Pain. And it's key to focus in on a couple things. It's really an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience. And it's and or that, that emotional experience and the sensory experience with actual, and the real kicker is, or potential tissue damage. So in this case, it's pretty obvious that we have tissue damage, we have structures changing, and that's responsible for pain concerns. But I would tell you that if we think broadly about just pain as a definition, even things like tinnitus, ringing in the ears, which we may know some people that are afflicted with, is an unpleasant sensory experience. And there may be some actual tissue concerns, but the reality is it's potential. And even that experience itself can be considered, if we just kind of shift our mind with regard to nomenclature, that that in and of itself could be considered a chronic pain condition. And oftentimes it's treated as such. So I mentioned this just to kind of give a broad scope as to the definition. Now, if we look at suffering can kind of be interpolated as right next to pain, but there's an element that's unique. It's really where the events that are taking place really threaten the intactness of that person. The intactness meaning I might have pain, but I don't feel that my life is threatened, or the fibers of my being are being threatened. And suffering really can have this other emotional quotient, but it focuses on this intactness of the individual. And they can be interpolated, but at the same time, distinct. Now, I mentioned this kind of with a grain of salt, is that this was a New York Times article. I originally went, I'm a proud product of the University of California and at UCLA, where I went to school and did some of my training. Pauline Chen is one of our surgeons there, and she gave a commencement address at graduation, and she's a good friend. Her father was going through several concerns with cancer, and really the fact that in 2012, the thought was, well, she was surprised as a physician that we didn't have more focus in our cancer centers with respect to developing pain management. And really the last decade has been a thrust to really kind of insert those individuals that have expertise in pain to be part of the picture as we work alongside great oncologists and oncological surgeons like Dr. Randall. So the scope of the problem here, when we look at this, is kind of mentioned in the epidemiology, but if we look at how individuals and how they experience their pain, we know that at diagnosis, anywhere from 30 to 45% of individuals can experience moderate to severe pain. And so at diagnosis, there's some element where pain still serves as an alarm. It's that alarm system that perpetually tells us something's going on. Now, where that chronicity of the pain comes about is where the snooze button on that alarm clock is broken. And it's like, yes, I know I have the problem in my knee, but it continually tells me this information as that input comes into the cord and to the brain. And so it's keeping that in mind. And some of our strategies to treat pain will be influencing that kind of an interplay of treating the alarm system. The average pain with TGCT really is patients suggesting on a numeric scale of around 5 to 6 out of 10. So it's substantial. People have pain with this. They know why they're having pain in the particular joint and location. And so certainly it warrants the need for pain management. So tumor-associated pain can have several circumstances. We know that there are some systemic treatments. We heard just briefly that radiation may not necessarily be recommended, right? But each one of our therapies, even surgery, radiation, even some chemotherapeutics in other types of malignancy, those types of treatments, although helpful to address the cancer, can in and of themselves provoke pain. So the question is having that fine line and understanding both of those scenarios. But in the point of being mindful is that controlling pain, our goals and intent to look at loss of control that can occur with this, have control and what's my quality of life. These are all the foci that we're going to try to focus on as objectives in trying to treat pain. Now there's some myths that if you're having if there's a diagnosis that it's inevitably accompanied by pain. And we mentioned that there's an average of around 6 out of 10 and people report pain, but not everyone. So, I'm an unbridled optimist. There's many people that can have the diagnosis of TGCT and they may not necessarily encompass that type of severe pain. But suffice to say, we're going to walk the line and understand that. Many pain therapies, there may be another myth. There's really nothing capable of relieving most of the pain, that advanced therapies should only be utilized when everything else has fallen short. And that if you're having this type of pain, only large doses of opioid therapy, morphine type products are needed over time because of tumor progression and really suffering, and that intactness of the human condition is being threatened is really a sign of tumor progression and problematic scenarios. And most of those aren't necessarily true. It's just we have to focus on each customized case for each individual. So, as we look at the number of individuals that have early stages of cancer and those individuals that experience pain, we see that it's substantial. And we know that the case for pain in the setting of cancer has been made. Many patients judge their pain as not necessarily well controlled or inadequate, which is going to lead us to this conversation a little bit further. And then really patients with TGCT often feel that, you know, it's a chronic, more rare disease, but they often feel unsupported, that it's really groups like this that we're able to kind of gel together and talk about it in this kind of a nice kumbaya effort where you can offer this kind of an understanding of the biology, but also what are the other things available for supportive care. So just to mention a brief service announcement on opioids. In 2011, you know, during the Obama administration, there was a consideration of understanding what are the drivers for costs in medicine. Medicine in the United States is very costly. What were some of the concerns? There was a report that was commissioned through Congress to the Department of Health and Human Services, and then subsequently to the Institute of Medicine. And that was in June of 2011, called Relieving Pain in America. And this is just at face value, not even mentioning TGCT or other types of cancer. The idea that 116 million Americans actually met criteria for chronic pain. And then with that, in the cost to billions of dollars, that amount or number of individuals surpassed really diabetes, cancer itself, and cardiac conditions as a global cost. And that the more common place of presentation for these patients that had chronic pain was the primary care setting first. And it was the number one reason people would report to the emergency room. So we certainly knew we had a huge problem, and seemingly an odd one, because we had a lot of folks in pain. And we also happened to prescribe the most opioids and consumed the most in the world at 80% of the supply. So this was something that you could see the trend, and this really was this concern for opioids and how good opioids are at treating pain. So are they the mainstay of really treating cancer-related pain? And I have to say there was a successful story in the 80s and 90s with the World Health Organization and the use of opioids as part of the analgesic ladder to treat pain. I have to say that there are many things and concerns that have been alluded to in the last several years, whether the propensity to addiction, the tolerance to the medication, dependence on medication, and some other factors that we just didn't realize. The idea that opioids can disrupt sleep, they can change our levels of testosterone in our body. There are several different concerns associated with chronic opioid therapy. Now, as we kind of looked at through this prism, we know that there are some strategies for partial agonist opioids like buprenorphine specifically, that have less concern for unintentional overdose death and have a more safe, efficient profile for treating pain. And we could talk more about that maybe in the Q&A, but suffice to say the bulk of the conversation will be sparing opioids and seeing what's available as we look at pain care. A little bit about cancer and bone pain. There's a great group over at the University of Arizona, Pat Manti and Bill, both of them are interesting pharmacists and microbiologists, but also I think Pat happened to have a JD degree, and I don't know why he went to law school, but aside from that, I tell you that they had a very great model of understanding bone pain, particularly in prostate cancer. They were able to determine that when inoculating certain prostate cancer cells into the long bones of femur, it tended to provoke, by way of communication through the immune system, a great interplay of microfilaments that would grow in greater propensity over the surface of the bone. So there is this communication between cancer, the immune system, and the development of neural filaments. And there is a process of understanding that that sensitivity to bone, the periosteum, the very surface of the bone itself, has a sensitive nature to it and can be changed with this interplay. This has led to understanding if we give nerve growth factor inhibitors, can it alter the course of that communication between cancer, the immune system, and the development of microfilaments, neural filaments, over the surface of the bone? And the answer is yes, but I think the jury's still out on understanding new drugs that can help reduce the propensity for this almost fishnet stocking neural filaments over the surface of the bone when you're afflicted with certain types of cancer. Now, I'll start off with very kind of global approaches to pain, and that have been successful for some: acupuncture, hypnosis, the understanding of guided imagery. These are all activities that can be very useful. Guided imagery and cognitive behavioral therapy are methodologies of using our own innate governor, our ability to attenuate pain in a better fashion with support groups, and those can be helpful. Therapeutic massage in certain areas, yoga, and trying to allow for the body to move in the setting of cancer, or the appropriate type of physical therapy or prehabilitation and rehabilitation in cancer, have also been demonstrated as effective, as it increases blood flow and what's necessary to certain muscles, tendons, bones, and tissues. So as you notice here, there's a little discussion about nutrition and anti-inflammatory diets and what that might mean. There are as many that suggest that although non-steroidals, the ibuprofens, the Motrins, the Mobics of the world can be helpful, all non-steroidals block a certain molecule that is prostaglandins, a molecule that's heavily involved in the inflammatory cascade. They block those molecules ubiquitously. And there happens to be, in good fashion, we've kind of named good actors and bad actors. There's good prostaglandins and bad prostaglandins, supposedly. What I would tell you, there's really no good and bad. They're just prostaglandins. But there are prostaglandins that provoke inflammation and others that help to resolve it. And it turns out that our non-steroidals block all of them, even the important ones of resolution to resolve inflammation, ubiquitously. So there's a sense that you can kind of have a persistent inflammation even with using Motrin, Mobic, and the Naprosyns and the Aleves of the world. Suffice to say, physical therapy can be key, and there's many other strategies to assist with pain. So what would those be? If we look at medications in general, we kind of have a rational polypharmacy approach. And I know what you might be thinking, what do you mean rational? Is prescribing medications or more than one irrational? And the real idea is using more than one medication at lesser doses, the doses that would potentially cause a potential side effect as we increase dose. So using a lesser dose, but at specific times of the day that are most necessary for that particular concern. So I'll try to unpack that. If we look at, for example, nerve pain, you can use elements like anticonvulsant therapy like gabapentin, which is a medication that can reduce the firing of information, nerve information coming from the knee joint, for example, reduce that information that's entering into the cord from the periphery. And you can do that with at the cost of potential sedation. So we prescribe gabapentin in the evening. Whereas there are some medications that are specialized for pain that are antidepressants that are actually stimulating. And we use those medications in the morning. And we'll combine both at lesser doses, both in the morning and evening, taking advantage of the side effect profile of stimulation in the morning and their side effect profile in the evening of sedation to achieve the goal of synergy to produce an analgesic or pain relieving effect. So many of the medications we use, some of them you may not have heard of, and they can be helpful in TGCT. So steroids, some potential use of NSAIDs. You've heard me talk about the World Health Organization ladder. The use of certain types of opioid, I would say what's supplanted, classic opioid therapy would be buprenorphine as a safer opioid. The use of certain types of CBD products. Now, you may find this unusual that we're talking about it, but it's really everything that's available to you. We know that marijuana in many of its forms, although has been considered taboo in the United States, has come of vogue in understanding its use for both for medicinal use in several states. CBD products that don't incur THC, which is a psychoactive component, particularly CBDA, have been helpful in inflammation and in some instances actually allowing for bone deposition. So there's a lot of study looking at CBD and in particular CBDA. And we could unpack that if there's more in the question and answer session. Calcitonin, other bisphosphonates to assist with bone deposition in the setting of erosions, for example, with repeat surgeries like what we talked about earlier. And capsaicin, there's as a neuropathic kind of analgesic. We talked about for nerve pain, let's talk about the fact that if you have injury post-surgery, there are several medications. And if this seems overwhelming, it's meant to be that way because it's to provide optimism and energy and enthusiasm that there's lots of strategies to assist with pain. Gabapentin was an anti-seizure drug that really couldn't stop a seizure to save its life, but it was really repurposed in the periphery where we see that a tempest hurricane or storm in the brain that acts as an electrical hurricane is present when we have injury and tumor progression in the periphery, pushing on nerves, allowing for characteristic or uncharacteristic amplitude and firing of nerves in the periphery. So gabapentin found a home there. Its cousin pregabalin, also similar. Tricyclic antidepressants can be used for pain, particularly in the evening. Other types of anticonvulsants like Topamax can be used. Namenda, which is an agent that can be used to block a certain receptor that's involved in the constant feedback loop. Why does our pain not remit? Oftentimes the NMDA or N-methyl-D-aspartate receptors involved. So use of Namenda as an off-label agent can be helpful. And then several other agents like IV lidocaine therapies and IV ketamine. And we'll talk a little bit more about ketamine. Ketamine has received kind of another chapter. It's kind of like Stella got her groove back with a new drug that was originally organized in the 60s by Dr. Domino at the University of Michigan. It's a phencyclidine derivative. So it has a relationship to PCP. There's a psychoactive component that is involved, but it was originally ushered in as an anesthetic used in the operating room. And what it's been found is that its primary workhorse in Vietnam for use as an anesthetic, a battlefield anesthetic. But ketamine has incredible benefits for nerve pain and reducing that perpetual feedback loop of pain. And we have created a ketamine infusion therapy program at our cancer center, specifically for large tumors and resections and persistent pain, neuropathic pain after resection or after chemotherapy, for example. So it's helpful in all of these conditions and can be useful. There are some contraindications, which I'll kind of move through. I will mention this, in 2019, ketamine only came up with another use, and you may find this as another kind of newsflash. Ketamine in and of itself, not only as a pain reliever and as an anesthetic, but the metabolite of ketamine, so ketamine passing through the body, through the liver, formulating norketamine, then that metabolite coming through the liver again, producing hydroxynorketamine. Hydroxynorketamine, this compound, had no analgesic or pain-relieving properties at all, but it turned out to have an exceptional antidepressant quality. And most antidepressants take effect in about 6 weeks. In this case, ketamine in its secondary metabolite form functions in 3 days. So it's being used as an intranasal rapid antidepressant. There are several different types of compounded therapies that can be placed over the knee, for example. This is actually compounding creams that are specialized creams with a vehicle, meaning the actual molecules that drive the actual medication through the dermis into the tissues, like liposomal, a vehicle that can do that. And we impregnate the cream with ketamine, local anesthetic, and certain anti-inflammatory agents. So we can actually create compounded creams that are helpful. These are all specialized therapies. This brings us down to the next part of the cornucopia of treatment and looking at things. And this is really what our new horizon is called neuromodulation, spinal cord stimulation, peripheral nerve stimulation, and targeted drug delivery. So neuromodulation can take place at the joint itself. We have several practitioners in our group that can place electrodes along the knee, stimulating the genicular nerves, which are small nerves that give innervation to the knee joint itself. And we actually do a test block where we block the small nerves of the knee. We can actually assess if this would be helpful. We can do a trial where we place these electrodes over those locations and stimulate those nerves. Now, of course, there are some limitations. One is, would repeat MRIs be required? Where are most likely? And these companies are rapidly becoming MRI compatible. Currently, some of them are MRI conditional, which allows us to use them. Secondarily, even the shoulder joint, for example, we're using these for frozen shoulder even after stroke, and they can be useful as a strategy to address knee pain. And this is somebody after knee replacement having persistent pain after knee replacement. This was actually multiple revisions, 6 to 8 surgeries, if I remember correctly, with these placement of these electrodes. Radio frequency ablation, actually burning the small sensory nerves that go to the knee joint. It can be repeated. The nerves do grow back, but there is a law of diminishing returns after repeat ablations, but can be helpful mitigating pain, allowing patients to engage in gentle physical therapy to try to maintain and not regress when it comes to activity and structure of muscle around the knee. And these are how we perform this particular procedure. And this is genicular radio frequency ablation, burning the small nerves that give sensation to the knee. Targeted drug delivery is the use of specialized medications directly to the central nervous system by delivery with a pump, an intrathecal pain pump. And there are a whole host of new medications that are being developed that are well-focused at treating pain at the level of the central nervous system. And so this is kind of a burgeoning new horizon for understanding how to treat progressive aggressive cancers that are causing pain and can be used in some more chronic conditions with a very prudent, judicious approach. some of these medications, substance P saporin is being reviewed at one lab in San Diego, for example. This has a incredible ability to treat bone cancer related pain in dogs, and is now being interpolated for its use in humans, and is on the horizon. Resiniferatoxin, very similar. It comes from a cactus that's has a very specific bind to a receptor that's involved in how we feel heat when we have burning associated pain. Ziconotide is from the depths of the ocean. It's from a sea snail called a conotoxin. And this medication is a calcium channel blocker. Local anesthetics like bupivacaine, even octreotide, and we can even place anti-nausea medications directly through the pain pump. This article just basically, or slide, serves to tell you that pain pumps and treating cancer-related pain is not new. It's just an art form in medicine that is rarely practiced, and it goes way back into the 80s and 90s, and we're still using this therapy and can be used with great success. So I mentioned a number of those things. I know it was a rapid review of pain therapies for TGCT and broad scope of cancer-related pain. So I wanted to take some time if there was questions. Thanks again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Copenhaver. I know Dr. Randall has to leave at 1 o'clock exactly. Do you have a little bit of flexibility, like 10 extra minutes to go over some more questions, Dr. Copenhaver?
I do.
Okay, so we'll start with Randall just so he can answer some of the questions. And so one of the questions we got was, can someone with maybe moderate pain safely choose to wait and postpone surgery? Or how would you treat maybe the wait and see approach? Who is best for that?
Great question. And Dave, that was very nice. Thank you. I learned a great deal there. So you can definitely wait and see. Just as symptoms are really the driver here. If the knees, whatever joints involved or whatever tendon areas involved, if it's not bothering you, it's okay to wait and see, have your surgeon or your provider follow you along. Hopefully, if it's an orthopedic surgeon, they will certainly talk to you about the idea that you may get some secondary arthritic changes from the tumor, but that's not always the case, and concern is not a reason to put you through a bunch of drugs or a bunch of treatment if you're really not that symptomatic. So I can't give you a definitive answer. The short answer is yes, you can wait and see. The more intermediate answer is yes, but you need to be followed closely.
Thank you. You also, since you mentioned some of the drugs, had a quick question about the percentage of patients who decide to go on the drugs and how many of them actually successfully stop the drug. I know a lot of that's currently still going on in research.
Yeah. So some patients just don't tolerate the drug, and so they get on it and they come off it pretty quick. Those are the minority of patients. Most people tolerate it pretty well. Might take a little adjusting. One of the key things to ask a patient who's on it is, are the mild side effects of the drug worse than the knee condition? So when we talk with our medical oncology colleagues, you know, any cancer is bad and needs treatment. That's not the case here. As I said in the answer to the other question, just because you have some doesn't necessarily mean you have a problem. Symptoms need to be a driver. And if the medicines or whatever the treatments are worse than the actual disease itself, then you might want to not go back to your doctors and just find an alternate treatment, because it's about maintaining your quality of life. But having said all that, many patients will go on the drug and it'll control them for long periods of time, and they'll go on, you know, it's the drug has been on the market now for a few years. So people have been on it for a few years and tolerated it quite well. We talk about possibly taking a holiday and seeing if the disease flares up. But that's a nuanced discussion one has with their provider about whether they want to try that or not. Obviously, if after a period of time it's really bothering you, when I talk to these patients, say, well, let's definitely put you on a holiday. Let's see how you do and see if your knee pain gets worse. But if the drugs are really starting to wear you down, then you need to stop.
Thank you. And this may be outside of maybe some of the realm of this discussion, but we did have a question that I wanted to get to you about like pathology coming back. So the pathology may come back as PVNS, a diffuse type, but how is that different than maybe diagnosis via MRI where it may say localized? Is there a difference between pathology and?
They look pretty much the same. And I'm not a pathologist, but I do look at this a lot, and I work with our pathologists, and there may be some very subtle differences. But if you take a nodule of solitary PVNS, cut it open, take a piece out and look at it in a microscope, and you take a diffuse piece and look at it under the microscope, they're going to look pretty much the same. And frankly, any good pathologist also looks at the radiology report. So that they will look at this and they'll say, pull up the MRI reports. Oh, it's diffuse. So this is probably diffuse. But if it comes into the pathology lab before they slice into it and it's a little solitary thing, the pathology report may say solitary tenosynovial giant cell tumor. I don't know if I made that clear or not, but.
Yeah, thank you. And I will say thank you for your time. I want to make sure you can get to your next appointment. So thank you. And if anyone has additional questions for Dr. Randall, please feel free to forward them to me and I can send them on to him later on.
Yeah, good luck to everyone. And thanks to everyone for being involved. And David, it's nice to see you. And everyone take care, okay? I'm sorry I have to take off.
Take care, Lori.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you, Dr. Copenhaver, for sticking around too, because there's a lot of to digest from that presentation. It was wonderful. THC is definitely discussed quite a lot amongst the groups. So what is your experience with the effectiveness of THC specifically for treating like chronic pain or bone pain?
THC, correct.
THC, and then maybe we can add CBD to the question as well.
Yeah, so the element of THC, there is an element that's analgesic. The only difficulty is the psychoactive part. So when we look at medicinal use of cannabis, the THC component is really what kind of detracts a little bit from the medicinal part, because CBD and it's the more sophisticated distilling, as we see. You know, there's no standardization for CBD products, and we kind of end up where you have to find that particular lab or that particular location that may have a very distilled form of CBD. So I would say that THC, you may have limitations because of the psychoactive part. Many people don't want to feel the effect of being high. But the idea of its use in smaller amounts when combined with other CBD agents has been helpful. And we have several folks that might be on a customized CBDA THC combination. We do know that if you just look at CBD alone, cannabinoids as a receptor are involved with that interplay of inflammation in the immune system and analgesia. So CBDA specifically, if you took anything away from the talk, I would probably tell the folks that CBDA probably has the greater use for joint related pain. Then the question is, where do I get CBDA? And then how do I get it very well distilled in a higher dose? And I can maybe pass that along to you, but that's certainly not my, I don't produce CBDA. I'm just a humble country pain doctor, but we happen to use it and it does help people spare opioids or even anti-inflammatories as an additional agent to help treat their pain.
Thank you. Just out of curiosity, what is your most common drug of choice that ends up being prescribed for chronic pain?
So I would tell you that in cases like TGCT, the idea of a joint causing pain, and we've broken down pain into two categories. This is kind of oversimplifying, but looking at it from neuropathic pain and inflammatory pain. If we look at neuropathic pain, we have a couple agents that are well received. And these are, how do we define that neuropathic pain? Usually pain is persistent. It has a temporal periodicity of a constant nature to it. Sharp, burning, electrical persistence, whether lying down, sitting, or standing, it's there. Gabapentin as a calcium channel blocker can be used. SNRIs, serotonin, norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, specifically duloxetine, have greater data behind them. Those are two for neuropathic pain. For inflammatory pain, we are left at a bit of a disadvantage. And those considerations are those NSAIDs, acetaminophen, but then you can use CBD products. You can combine compounded creams and therapies for the inflammatory concern. And then the rationale of using neuromodulation, those treatments that I mentioned of electrodes to disguise pain from the brain can be helpful.
Thank you. Would your answer change at all for minors? If there's someone who's skeletally immature, would you go more towards like the NSAIDs that may have a safer profile or a pain relief?
So for a minor, what I would say is interestingly, NSAIDs, although seemingly innocuous, we've learned more and more that nonsteroidals every day when taken can cause gastric ulcers, kidney concerns, and even cardiac concerns in some cases. So being careful, maybe perhaps focusing on ones that have less propensity for those issues like Celebrex can be helpful. And then I would certainly say that if the idea is if we have a young adolescent, young adult, maybe a 17, an 18 year old coming into their 20s, even doing genicular ablation is not a bad option of rendering the nerves insensate to the knee while you try to focus on healthy strategies of physical activity for the individual. And then the use of CBD products, even in that population, because there's no psychoactive component to CBD, the risks are low and the yields can be potentially high. But it's with each patient, it's customized and each individual have to have a good conversation for sure on risks and benefits with the parents and shared decision-making.
So since it is so customized, how do you recommend patients find pain specialists and possibly be taken seriously by providers?
So at some point, what I would say is that pain management in and of itself, these kind of robust, comprehensive programs are prevalent in many academic centers. I guess the only difficulty is that much like anything, the human condition, we're kind of siloed and fragmented because of our own nature that we don't communicate with other people. Meaning, even in the hospital, we'll have little cubicles or something that we're separating ourselves. We want our space, but really when we're taking care of patients, we want to have that multidisciplinary effort. So what I would recommend is if a patient that has this condition goes to an academic center or a larger hospital system to ask who they have in pain management, and is there any of those pain specialists that communicate with the oncologists and try to explore. It requires that self-advocacy, because unfortunately, just relying on the cancer center alone may not be adequate.
Well, thank you so much. We appreciate all of your time and for being here. And if patients have additional questions, I will also send them your way and can post them later.
No, not a problem. My pleasure. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you. And for everyone else, thank you for joining us as well. We should have this posted rather soon and keep up with more updates for additional webinars. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Copenhaver.
Take care. Bye-bye.